If I were a painter, I would paint my reverie.
Well, I'd like to welcome everybody to our Westlake Village Art Guild demos. And this is our, I don't know how many we've done this year, but Karen is our second to last. So we're savoring these last few Zoom videos. And Karen has done a workshop for us before, and she did one of our dinner demos before. And so I am absolutely so excited to have her here. As you all know, not all teachers are good teachers. They might be good painters, but they're not necessarily good teachers. And Karen is a fabulous teacher and a fabulous painter. And I don't want to talk too much because I want to get her started. And I'll let you go ahead and take it away.
Okay, thanks so much, Wendy. This is exciting for me too, because it's my first demo on Zoom. So yeah, so I'm very excited. And it's fun to be in my own studio doing this. This is great. A few of the things I want to mention before I get started is my motto for painting. And my motto is paint a lot of paintings and some of them will be good. So that lets you off the hook to, if you will allow it, to realize that not every painting you paint is going to be a good painting. So in other words, it also tells you to practice, that you've got to paint a lot of paintings in order to paint good paintings. So I'd like to start with that. And then a few things I want to mention before I paint is I'm represented at Mission Fine Art Gallery, which is right across the street from San Juan Capistrano Mission. I also have work at Vanessa Roth Fine Art in Laguna Beach. That's on a consignment basis. I'm not really represented by her gallery, but she does have some of my work. And then I'll be at the Balboa Art Walk on September 26th on the South Bay Front Seawall. So that's a fun event. And then I'm in the Oil Painters of America Salon Show in Gainesville, Georgia right now. So if you want to go on that website and look at their work, you'll see one of my pieces in that show. And I recently wrote a post for their blog. They wrote to me and invited me to write a post. And the title of the post is Still Life, More Than What You Might Think. So if you want some tips on still life, if you think, oh, I'll never paint still life, or you have a negative idea of still life, I challenge you to read that article, because it really does talk about the benefits of painting still life for any painter who works in any medium, and also who wants to paint all kinds of subjects. Still life can really be of benefit. I'm on Instagram as Karen Werner Art. And I also have a blog that I've kept, an art blog, since 2010. So if you're interested in seeing my progress, if you want to spend the time, you can go backwards through my blog and you can look at what my paintings look like when I started and what they look like today, if you're interested. And then my website is karenwernerart.com. So that's all the info. All right, so let's get started. Let me put this down. I've set up my camera so that you can see the painting, the palette, and the still life. And first of all, I spent quite a bit of time setting up still life today. And when I do, I arrange and arrange and arrange. And I look at it through a viewfinder, which you probably are familiar with, to find a good composition. I light my still life with a warm spotlight bulb, which gives it a dramatic sense of light, a very light side on every object, and then a beautiful shadow to add to the composition. So talking about composition and design, design is the most important thing whenever you're planning a painting. You want to start with a good design. This is one of my favorites. It happens to be a cruciform design. So that means it goes off the canvas on each side. This is a shadow that goes off on this side, and these are objects whose shadows go off on the bottom. So it results in negative spaces that are different sizes and different shapes. So that makes your painting more interesting because it has a really good composition. A lot of my paintings don't have one focal point. I like to have my viewers roam around in the painting and have lots of things to look at. So a lot of times I will not have a single focal point. For this painting, it's going to be right here. But still, your eye will roam around the canvas. Someone asked about the paint I use. I use mostly Utrecht paint. I do use some Gamblin and some other brands, but mostly Utrecht. So the colors I'm starting with is, the colors that I normally have on my palette is titanium white. This is a lemon yellow Utrecht. This is a Utrecht cad yellow light. Looks more like Gamblin's cad yellow medium, but it's a warm yellow. So this is my warm yellow. This is my cool yellow. And then I have a yellow ochre. I don't use it very much. I like to mix my own yellow ochres. And this is cad red light. This is Terra Rosa. I only have it on here because I use it in figure painting. I won't be using it tonight, probably. This is permanent. No. Quinacridone red. Mm-hmm. And this is alizarin, ultramarine. And I've got some viridian. I don't use it very often. And then I've got phthalo blue, and I do use that sometimes, but not always. And then this is a mixed green that I learned from Kim English. It's cad yellow lemon and Payne's gray. And it's a very useful green because it's grayed a little bit. And you can alter it to be warmer by adding more yellow, cooler by adding more blue, or you can add white for greens that are far in the distance. Because it's already a muted green, all you have to do is add a little bit of white to lighten it up for distant greens. So again, that is cad yellow lemon and Payne's gray. And if you have a chance, look at the work of Kim English.
The best.
This is transparent red oxide, which I use a lot. And this is burnt umber. I only use burnt umber for toning my canvas and for drawing in my design. I don't ever use burnt umber in my mixing or in my paintings because I think of burnt umber as dirt. So why would I want dirt in my colors, you know? But it makes a great go-to tone. It's neutral and it's warm. So it also dries fast. So what I've done so far is I toned my canvas with burnt umber. I wiped it until it was even with a paper towel. And then I drew in my my design, and I wiped out the places where I want very vibrant color so that the underneath layer of burnt umber doesn't influence the colors in those areas. So they're kind of the lights, but it's also where the color is going to be the most intense or the high chroma. And then I often will take this just like this and I'll put it outside in the sun for just a few minutes because burnt umber dries really fast. So then if there are passages that you have to wipe off for some reason and you've let your drawing dry, then you can wipe off and not lose your drawing. Does that make sense? Okay.
Yes.
All right. Okay, so I usually will start, I work back to front, and I usually work object by object, and I work dark to light. So I want to look at my background and find my darks first and paint those first. I also have to consider that I have flowers, and I almost always paint flowers first because they're going to change, move, and die. A tip for painting fruit, keeping it fresh, especially those oranges, they're going to dry up pretty fast. Have a little squirt bottle. You can kind of freshen it up a little bit so that the rinds don't start curling and dying. Okay, so I'm going to start with some background darks. I have pre-mixed some of my colors just to make my demo go faster. But when I paint still life, I do not pre-mix, except for maybe the surface that my still life is sitting on where I need a lot of it. I will pre-mix it, and I want to be really careful with the mixture that I come up with. So I'll pre-mix that. I'll also pre-mix in order to make sure that the shadow color and the color in the light relate to one another, as far as the surface that the painting is sitting on. And in plein air, I do pre-mix, but the rest of what I do is all with the brush. So I'm going to start with putting in some dark areas thinly, because I'll paint into them later. Might alter them a little bit.
Karen, they're wondering if you use a medium at all at this stage.
Sometimes I do, but most of the time I don't. Not at this stage for sure. Because I want my underneath layer to be thin so it has good adhesion to the canvas. So the old rule, fat over lean. So this needs to be lean to start with. That means not oil, not medium, you know. So I'm trying to keep it nice and loose. I want some of these to go off, and I want some transparency here. So I'm planning ahead to put the thick paint in the focal areas, which is the dish full of fruit. So I'm using kind of a loose and light approach.
Oh, Karen, we just lost your picture. Let me see.
Just a second. Am I back?
Yep, there you are.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Wonder if it's on a time thing where it clicks off after.
No, you know what? I got a phone call.
Oh,
I got a phone call. I hope I don't get any more. I usually don't get calls in the evening.
No problem. In the meantime, what's the canvas that you're working on? Is that a board or?
No, this is a Centurion, double primed oil linen, double primed linen.
And then you mat it on a board, or what? How did you?
Yeah. How'd you ask that? Okay. Did I lose you again? Okay.
Oh, you're back. You're back.
So I put it on a board. I put all my panels when I paint on a backing board so that I can paint off the edge of the canvas. So it's not down in here in the crack of the easel. And the way I do that is with loops of painter's tape. And it really works. The only thing you have to know is that you can't reuse the loops. Don't be too stingy. You can't reuse the loops because your painting will fall into your palette. And how do I know this?
It's happened.
Okay. Up here, I want something a little bit lighter with, so I added some white and yellow, some cool yellow. A little bit more green right here to frame that. Okay, so I've laid in a lot of my background area greens. That is a leaf right there. I'm gonna make it two-sided. And then I will cut in around it. So I don't have to worry about my shapes too much because I can cut in around them with my background. Okay, so I'm going to paint maybe not all the flowers, but a lot of them. Give you an idea. That was a hog bristle I was using. And this is a rosemary bristle, synthetic bristle. So here comes the transparent red oxide to make that nice transparent dark center of the sunflower. I find that sunflowers are one of the easiest flowers to paint. If you want to paint flowers and you get frustrated, go back to sunflowers. Start in the center. And then I will mix my cool colors of the petals, which is almost like a yellow ochre. So I have red, yellow, and blue mixed in here. Kind of thin the paint a little bit with turp. I want to be able to paint on top of this later. That got really dark. Can you see the colors okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So I'm gonna start here with some of my darks. I'm gonna alter it a bit. One of the things that painting a lot teaches you is brushwork. You don't get beautiful brushwork without painting a whole lot. And then your brush becomes an extension of your arm and your hand. So now I'm going to dip into my pure yellow for the light parts, which can be done a couple of different ways. And this still has a little bit of the yellow ochre mixture in my brush because I didn't clean my brush. So I'm gonna make sure I make a break there. I don't want every single, that one coming down this way, every single petal to be painted. And still, I've reserved the pure yellow. I still haven't got that in yet. So I could do that. Add a little bit of red to it, because this is kind of an orangey yellow that I see. But now I don't have any blue in that mixture. See how that kind of stands up now, because of the contrast. I don't want to put it everywhere. And I can always go back in later, going back to my, cut that off. Okay. I can put in some of my dark things around. Edges here. Some of these sweet little skinny things. We want to make them irregular. We don't want them to all be the same size, all be the same distance apart, all be the same shape. You don't want to paint soldiers. I think that's okay. And I can go back in and put some lighter greens in there. And I can also soften this edge a little bit. I like that better. Okay, so it's painted really simply. I'm gonna move on to the yellow flower next to it, show you how I would do that kind of a flower. And I'll work in the center also. And I see two different things. I see the flower in shadow up here, and I see the flower in light down here. So I'm gonna mix those colors. It's more of a lemony, so oops. So I'm gonna pick up the Cad Yellow Lemon. This is Utrecht's Cad Yellow Lemon. Cool it with a little bit of ultramarine. Borders on green there. I'm squinting down to see the shape of the color. Oh, that's really bright. So I'm going to add the opposite, which is red. Gotta know your complementary colors. That's way too high chroma for what I want there. So this is gonna be more like it. Meanwhile, instead of painting on top of what you know is wrong, you just wipe it out. Okay, that's a much better color. And I'm thinking about the shape of the flower, but trying to paint it as simply as possible. Okay, now I'm gonna go around the center part and get a little bit of the shadow color down in here. And now I'll go in, get that on my brush, go in with a clean lemon yellow. So I'm gonna put a tiny bit of red in it, see what happens. Might work. Yeah, that'll work. Okay, so that looks lit compared to the other part of it. I don't want to paint every single petal. So these strokes are representing the short little petals that are near the center. And then I'll put in some longer ones. Irregularly spaced, different shapes, different sizes. Put some really thick paint right there. I don't know if any of you do this, but with a glass palette, I hope you can see my palette. With a glass palette, you can load your brush like this, load it up really good, and you can scoop it till you have like a bead on the end. And then you can put some really nice thick mark where you want it. Maybe that's common knowledge, I don't know. Okay, the little tiny pieces that go around the inside. Okay. I need a little bit more. So it doesn't have to look exactly like it, but it just needs to say chrysanthemum. Little darks in the middle with the green that I already have used. Okay, so that's how I would do those flowers. While I've got it, I've put a little bit of this up here. For some harmony later. Put some back here. Okay, while I've got my greens, some light on the leaves and the stems in the vase. I always do the stems first before I try to paint a jar. The jar almost always comes last because you need all the colors that are in the surrounding area in order to paint the jar. So, ooh, that's a really reddish stem back there. That's gonna be lovely. So I'll pick up a lot of alizarin. It's reading its black, so we get some of that out of there. There we go. Red oxide in there. Everything inside the jar is blurry, so I don't want perfect shapes. Okay, here's my green, my pre-mixed green that I learned from Kim English. I'm gonna alter it a little bit with this dark green just to start, because these are coming out from in front, from underneath the leaves, a little bit lighter there. And put some more red in there.
Karen, I have a question for you.
Sure.
If you've already said the center of focus is going to be what's on the plate.
Right.
How do you soften or make that the background, what you're painting now? I would think it's easy to get into little details and want to get all that stuff in there, but if that's not what you want your eye to look at, how
I get this out of the way first, because I start loose and I tend to tighten up. So, and I don't want it to be tight. And also I work from back to front. So I don't know, it just makes sense for me to do this first.
But do you put more thicker paint on the stuff on the plate and brighter colors or something? Or how do you?
You'll see part of the setup is that the blue, I'm going to use some phthalo blue in that bowl. So just the high contrast in the bowl is going to do a lot to keep the eye there. Okay, so normally I would do the rest of the flowers while I'm nice and loose. But I'm going to skip now to the objects inside the bowl. And I'll start from back to front. So I'm going to start with the oranges. That orange that's going off the edge, purposely off the edge of the bowl. So I'm making a color of the rind in shadow. You need, well, I like to think, and I teach people how to think about everything as having a light side and a dark side, just like Star Wars. So let's see, that's a little light for the dark side. And I'm mixing red, yellow, and blue. Let me know, Wendy, if at any time people can't see.
No, so far so good. What they do is they write questions for you and then I ask you, so.
Okay, great. So this is the shadow side of the rind that I'm seeing. Now I'm going to use what's in my brush, but make it a little bit more high chroma for the part in the light. And now I want to transition. Okay, and this part is in shadow. Okay, now I'm going to paint the center part of or the flesh of the orange, I guess you would call it. This part right here is in the light more than this part. So for this one, I'm going to put a tiny bit of blue in it to make the shadow, slightly shadow color. See how that looks. That works pretty well. A little bit darker toward the bottom. And it's a little bit yellower right there. Okay, now the other part in the light. Leaving a space for the rind. The white part, I don't know, there's a name for that white part. I always forget what it is. And there's some thicker paint there. And let's put a little bit thicker paint here on this edge. I'm gonna let it go out of the lines so that it can sort of harmonize with the background a little bit so it doesn't look like it's cut out and pasted on. Okay, the center part of this. I probably should have painted that strawberry first. Let this come out. And then there's a little triangle here in the shadow. And this is a little bit influenced by the cherry. So I'm going to put a little bit of that shadow color here. And we need to change this shape. Okay, now I'm going to do the white part of, which is not white. Our mind tells us it's white, but if you look with your eyes, it's not white. It almost has a little bit of an orange color to it. So I'm mixing the yellow in with a little bit of red, not much. That's the color I see. get thicker right here. Wider, I should say. This one is almost completely facing the light, so I add some more white to it. It's wider. There we go. And it's rounder. This is really bright right here. I'm just going to use some white with some yellow in it. Might have a little bit of the red in it. I'm going to make it nice and thick. Okay, there's a little triangle here. Let's put a little here. And there are little sections that I can see. I don't want to paint them all perfectly because that would be pretty boring and not very poetic, but I'm just going to put a little hint of them. A little bit more on my brush. There we go. Okay, so there are those oranges. Let's do these real quick. Okay, great.
You could actually go down a bit and get rid of the background, the studio stuff.
So push it down, oh, Karen.
You would see the whole palette that way. Yeah, yeah.
Is that better?
Let's see.
Wow.
Oh, there you go.
Okay, sorry. I've got somebody keeps on calling me. I hope it's not an emergency. You know, it's a friend of mine. Okay. I need some real saturation right here. I'm gonna put some thicker paint. All right, and then the shadow color. Actually, I don't see that much of it. All right, now the shadow color of the rind. The rind in shadow is a kind of a gray. Your brain tells you that it's white, but it's not white in shadow. So I'll start with white and I'll put in some of the color that's in my light, but I'm gonna add blue to it, and that was way too much. But you can't see what I'm doing now, right?
A little bit. We see the edge of that pile.
Okay. It's a little bit of a gray. So I'm finding this part of the rind that's in shadow. And I won't know if it looks right until I put it on my painting. So let's try this. I think that'll read okay. Could be a little bit darker, but I'm not going to worry about it. There's a little bit of shadow right here cast from this orange. Okay, let's do some strawberries. So I paint almost all my paintings with just one brush. This is an 8. No, it's a 6. So I'll start with the dark of the strawberry, the part that's in the shadow. I use my cool red, which is alizarin. That's not cool enough, so I'm going to add a little bit of blue to it. course, you know, it's in a blue bowl. So the blue is reflecting up into it. This is really going to give it some punch right there. That's in shadow. This part over here is in shadow. I'll add the green parts later. You notice I didn't even draw the green parts because I don't want to have to paint around those little things.
Is this a 10 by 10 canvas, Karen? Or
no,
is
this a 12 by 12.
12 by 12.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, now I'm going to do the strawberries in the light. I'm mixing alizarin into my cad red light so that I have somewhere to go that could be pure cad red light if I see something that bright. Now transition.
And when you say transition, what are you putting in there?
I mixed a little bit of the shadow color with the light color that I mixed. So I'm thinking, like I said before, I'm thinking of everything as the object in shadow, the object in light. So this is the object in the shadow. This is the object in the light. And in between those two, for a soft edge on the cast shadow, I mix an in-between color. So here comes my my in-between color, and it rounds the corner there. I think I want to change this dark a little bit. And I'm going outside the lines purposely, because when I cut back in to make the shape of the strawberry, some of the red will mix in with the blue of the bowl, and it will look like they're sort of married together and they're together in space rather than cut out and paste it on. It creates sort of soft edges, or you might say. Okay, now the cherries. Those cherries are just almost black. They're so dark. So let's see. I'm going to use alizarin and ultramarine. I'm going to paint the shadow side first, and I may sort of punch up the light side to more than I see, more red than I see. Again, I'm painting outside the lines. So it doesn't look like I was working in a coloring book. This comes up against here, and that beautiful dark cool red will set off the light of the strawberry. And I want this color also to influence the orange. So I'll drag my brush through there. Okay, a couple more cherries. Cherries are not perfectly round. If you look at them carefully, they are not perfectly round. They have some little squared off looking parts. This one might be nice, just that color. And the one behind it, I want it to influence. And I want it to influence that orange. So I'm going to take some of my alizarin. I'm just going to kind of make it like it's bleeding a little bit. Gives it a softness and imperfection. I like the saying that I want my paintings to look like fresh sushi, not well done beef. That's what I'm going for. Even though I don't eat sushi, I want my paintings to look like that. Okay, so let's do this one that's in front of me. Definitely has a dark side that is right near me. Very dark. I'm going to drag some into the shadow so that it will influence the shadow when I put the shadow on there. Now I'll do the light sides of the cherries. I don't want to push it too far because then they're just going to look just like the, that's not bad, just like the strawberries.
Karen, are you also thinking warm and cool?
All the time.
Okay.
All the time, yeah. Okay, there's red on this one. And this one is even warmer, the one toward me. So I'm going to use mostly, no, that won't even look like a cherry. There we go. A little bit more lizard in there. Okay. Didn't do that other orange. That's all right. Okay, I've got everything in the bowl done, right? I think so. Mm-hmm. I can put some of the green in shadow. Might need a little more yellow in that so it'll show up. That's too bright, so I'm going to drop the chroma by adding the opposite. That's better. And then there's some in the light. This is in shadow. The whole center is in shadow. The center of the little green thing. And I'm putting the shadow color in first. And then I'll put in the light. So I'm going to do that lemon, which I love painting lemons. I've painted a lot of them because I have a lemon tree. I have a Meyer lemon tree, which isn't giving me any lemons right now, so I had to buy this lemon, kind of cramp my stuff. Okay, so I switched to a bigger brush because I don't want there to be a lot of detail in this lemon, because it's definitely not part of the focal area. Now I've got red, yellow, and blue in all of this. It might be a little too light. So I'm going to add a little bit more blue, a little bit more red. Oops, that was way too much red. Some blue in here. I think that might do it. It doesn't look right, but I think it will look right on the canvas. Can you hear me mumbling to myself? Okay. Do it with as few strokes as possible. I see a lot of reflected light on the bottom of that lemon because of the white surface. But if you paint it as light as you see it, you're gonna lose the shadow side of your lemon. So now the lit side. I'm gonna make a transition first. So I mixed in a little bit of my other color. And I try not to lick my canvas, like, you know, stroke, 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 like you're painting a house, a wall in your house, and you don't want any of the other color to show through. The only time I lick my canvas is when I am trying to blend the paint on the canvas. Otherwise, I think licking is just a bad habit. So here's the highlight. The highlight is always the color of the object, the color of the light, plus white. So that will read as a lemon. But I do need a little doodad on the end, maybe. Could be green or brown. Okay. All right, I'm ready for the bowl. How are we on time?
You're doing great. It's almost six.
Wow, that's going by fast. Okay. Let me do the shadow on, or the highlight on the strawberry first, because I won't be able to get in there. So the color of the strawberry plus white plus the color of the light, which is warm light bulb, so I add white. I mean, I add yellow. And so this is red, yellow, and white for the highlight. Highlights are not pure white unless they are on glass or metal. And even then, they pick up the color of the light. Now I see a ton of highlights, but you don't want to paint them all because then it looks sort of amateurish, I think. You just have to give an indication. I think this one wasn't white enough, so I put some more white in it.
Karen, when you frame your paintings, do you need to use a floater frame because you go all the way to the edges like that?
A lot of times, yes, and I've tried to reform myself and it just doesn't work.
Yeah.
Okay, phthalo blue, yowza, watch out. Stand back, everybody. Okay, so in the shadow, I'm gonna paint the phthalo blue in the shadow. I'm talking about the bowl now. So I'm mixing the shadow color. Cad red light is perfect for this because it's an orangey red. There we go. Okay, so I'm going to carve my way around these things. And try to do it very simply. I can overlap because the teacher's not going to say you went out of the lines. Now, some of this is going to get lighter, but for right now, I'm just erring on the side of being too dark. It's better to paint something too dark than to paint it too light and try to correct it. So I'm painting my shadow shapes. Ooh, that shadow comes all the way down there. It's really, really dark up against this orange though. Super dark back here. Which will pop that orange forward. Now I can shape my strawberry. And be thinking about the shape of the shadow. Pretty dark right here. Okay, now where it gets lighter, I'm just going to add a little bit of white and maybe a tad bit of yellow because I know I've got a little red in there. So I'm gonna, since I added the white, I'm just gonna warm it a tiny bit with a little bit of yellow. Actually, that's pretty dark back there. Okay, a little bit more white there. Trying to match the value that I see in the rest of the shadow. Shadow is grade 8. They are darkest under the object that is making the shadow. And then they get lighter as they move away from the object. So this area of shadow is lighter than the part that's right up against the orange. So is this one. And I can overlap because that will blend on the canvas. And I'm thinking about the shape of the shadow. This one's a little bit lighter, not much. Let me go back and darken that. There we go. Okay, and now I have a shadow from the flower arrangement. A little bit of variation in there. Okay, ask yourself, color of the bowl that's not in the light. Well, this is somewhat muted down here on this side of the bowl because this is, it's casting a shadow on itself because the light's coming from this direction. So this side of the bowl is getting the most light and this side, of the other side of the bowl is kind of in shadow a little bit. Not as dark as the dark shadows, but it's not as light as the light, that's for sure. Kind of like a cup. When I teach, I always draw a cup. Now I can shape the cherries. Doesn't take much. When you put a highlight on it, it will look rounder. Okay. This actually meets this one. Can you hear the crows outside?
Yes, I thought that was at my house.
No. Okay, now I'm checking the shape of my shadows. And now I'm going to paint the part of the bowl that's in the light. I do have a little skinny thing underneath. I really can't see much of this, but for the painting, I think it's going to need that, a little something under there. Okay, now the color of the bowl in the light. I'll start with phthalo and add white to it. I don't think that's going to be the color that I need. Awfully intense. I think I'll add a little bit of yellow. Warm it up so it's not so icy. Not quite that blue. Might not match the bowl exactly, but that's okay because this is a painting, not a photograph. Okay, so let's see what this looks like. Don't know if it's the right value. I actually don't see it that blue. I see it with, I'm going to put some ultramarine in it. Sometimes you don't know until you put down a little dab. See how this, that's a little bit better. Boy, is it intense. I'm gonna put some red in it to knock it down a little bit. There's red in the shadow color, so why not? There we go. That might be it. I'm gonna get some of that off of there. Better to wipe off than to keep putting stuff on top of the mark that you know is wrong. That's better. This is a little bit faster than how I would paint if nobody was watching me. I would slow down a little bit. Now, I don't have the light parts in yet, but that's okay for the tops of the strawberries. Now this part does get lighter. Add a little bit of white. Now this part is away from the viewer, so I'm going to tone it down a little bit. That helps the other part to come forward. I put a little red in it, and I'll put a little bit of white in it. Sort of gray it. Okay, now back to the clean parts that are in the light. So I'm shaping the shadow and the cherries. If I get a little bit of that alizarin in it, I'll be happy because that's what I want. Something that looks more like a painting. Something that's a little imperfect. There's another saying I like. I think I heard it from Brenda Swenson. Do you want your painting to be irritatingly perfect or charmingly incorrect? I like that.
I like that.
Have you heard that before, Wendy?
No, but I think I'll use that, especially when my paintings are incorrect. I'll say it's charming. I did it on purpose.
Charmingly incorrect. That is really bright. Okay, now for a cast shadow, I use an edge softening thing that is called a penumbra that I learned from Carol Marine, but it's actually a scientific term for the edge between light and shadow. It gets a little bit lighter as the shadow comes to the edge. So I'm going to take my shadow color and my light color and mix them together to get an in-between color. And I'm going to put it right, I always say right on the border of California and Mexico. Feather blender to blend it into oblivion like they did in the 15th century. That's impressionism, letting your stroke show instead of blending everything out. Depends on, you know, what style you're going for. So a little bit of it right here. I might take some of my orange color, which would be this one maybe, and put some of it right here. The orange is maybe a little bit lighter, reflecting on the side there. Okay, I think lights are not light enough. I'm gonna adjust that a little bit. And it'll really have a nice value contrast, I'm hoping. Yeah. Just putting it where I see it the light, the lightest. Okay, I'm going to put some highlights on those cherries. First, I'm going to get some rind on that, just a little detail on that. Orange, a little pop of light there. Same thing here. Liking the shape of this, so I'm going to take some of my shadow color and lose the bottom of that. That's better. I want this to go over the orange, I mean the blue there, like smooshed a little bit. All right, let me paint that lemon in shadow up to the edge and put some of that blue in it. Little bit of phthalo influencing that lemon. Okay, now the lights on are the light parts of the strawberries. I'm going to try my mixed green and see if it's light enough. It may not be. Nope. I'm going to put some white in it and some cool yellow. It's still a grayish green. Here we go. This green needs to be a little darker. Okay. Let me straighten out the shape of this cherry a little bit. There we go. We got a little bit lost there. Okay. Now for the cherries, like I mentioned before. Okay, color of the cherry plus white plus the color of the light, which is warm. So I add yellow. I don't want to put all of them. I have to be judicious, pick a few. I scooped the paint so that I could lay on a nice thick blob on top. This one's bigger. And this one's tiny. And that one is too round for my liking, so I'm going to unround it a little bit more. And this cherry. You have to look at how big is it? Where is it on the cherry? We tend to, at least I do, make highlights too big. Better to make them small. And this one's bugging me. That's a little bit better. Okay, now I reserved some pure cad red light for some punchy areas that will make this side definitely the lit side. Now we have a feeling of where the light's coming from. I probably should have done it before I put the highlights on, but I didn't think of it at the time. This needs to be a little bit different shape. There we go. Okay, let me stand back. I think that's looking pretty good. The shape of that, orange isn't right. So I'm gonna use my handy wipeout tool. I know what's wrong with it. It needs to come down that way. And the color is shadow. I don't have much of it, but maybe I have enough. And a thin. A little bit better. So I've mixed some violets. And the reason why I'm using violets is not because shadows are purple, but because on a white surface, sometimes shadows look purple. And sometimes on concrete outside. Switch back to my hog bristle because I want to paint thinly. I'm putting in the darkest part first, and then it's going to gradate a bit. Might be too purple, so I'll put a little bit of yellow in it. Gray it a little bit. I love purple. There we go. That's a nice gray, purpley gray. That would come right up to the orange of that orange and be so lovely, the opposite color. This will come to the, then it gradates out, gets even lighter. Let's try this. I'm trying to make this thin. A variety of paint application is always beautiful in a painting. So I want some thin passages and some thick passages. Oops, this goes down here. And down here, it picks up the orange.
Ooh, yummy. Shape of the shadow. Now the shadow here is about the same value. Okay, underneath the lemon is very dark. I should have taken some of the lemon in shadow down under here into the shadow shape. So I'll just do that now, and it's going to influence the shadow under the lemon. And it gets lighter as it moves away from the lemon. Yeah. And I don't want to put much into that because that's, we don't want the eye to go there much. Okay, and very thin shadow over here. My hair bugs me. Oh, this is really influenced by yellow right there. I can see it in there, right here. But it's lighter. There we go. This, it comes behind the flower. Bluer here. Goes all the way back here, but it gets thinner and lighter. Let's put a little. Wait a minute.
You know, I was thinking, Karen, you were saying about the importance of doing still lifes, that you really do learn so much from doing them. I think even just setting up a still life is incredibly difficult to make an interesting composition. And you see so many still lifes that are so stagnant. Yours are kind of, they feel fresher and filling up the whole canvas, and it's very difficult to do. You make it look very easy.
Well, it just takes practice like anything. But when you set up, you want to zoom in on your subject, get close, zoom in, let it fill and let it go off. Then you create those, like I talked about earlier, that are interesting. If you put everything in the center with floating stuff around it, nothingness around it, it's not as interesting as if you have filled up the space. So, does this give you an idea of the thin passages of shadow? I hope.
Yes, it's beautiful.
It doesn't read until you get the light on there. So let me put a little bit of light, and you can see how the whole thing is gonna pop, I hope. I did pre-mix that. So I would use a really big brush so that I can cover ground quickly and not make it too, overworked. As few strokes as possible. So here's a color that I would use for that white. It's white with red and yellow in it.
Ooh, talk about yummy.
Yeah, I would try to not paint this like I'm painting the side of my house. In other words, I would let some of the original tone show through in little spots. So now I can shape Hope this doesn't have phthalo in it. Shape the cherry, which is wider toward me and narrower at the back. I'm gonna cut it off if I need to. This side's a little bit more cut off than that. Shape the shadow now. So you really can do yourself a big service if you forget about all those coloring books you colored when you were a kid. This comes right up to the edge of the orange. And then I would go back in here and maybe put in a few strokes. You don't want any information in the corner. Some thicker paint. This is the shadow of the little cherry stem that is gonna go, you know, across there. And I do the same thing with these cast shadows that I did here. I'll mix this color and this color, and I'll put it right on the border, and it will read as a soft edge called a penumbra. Let me do a little stem, if I could. Again, these beautiful synthetic bristles, either by Rosemary is what I use, or even Silver Brush Company has some nice synthetic bristles. You can get a nice bead on it for making lines. You don't have to get out a rigger. See, this is gonna go this direction. I have to be lighter. See how thin that can be?
Karen, this is Diana.
Hi, Diana.
Hi. I'm anxious to see how you handle the white table behind the lemon and the fruit plate to show that it doesn't flatten out the painting, otherwise, so it goes to the distance.
Right. That is really good. Uh-huh. So what I do is I put in my shadow, my color in the light, shape this first, which I haven't done very well here because I'm trying to hurry. Okay, and then I would take some of my shadow color and mix it in, this purpley color. So I mix them both together and I create an in-between color. Do you see how that's a little bit cooler?
Yes.
That helps it look like it's receding into space as a horizontal plane. That's even a little bit cooler than that. So all I've done is I've used the purples that I had, and I'll let them mix on the canvas. Now here's where I can cut in and out to make of my if you cut out, you drag some of the yellow into it, which is very nice. And if you cut in, you can make a really nice shape of whatever it is. Shape some of these leaves. This is a big brush. This is an 8, fairly big. Okay, so now that's the color that's going to help it recede. And then I would go back to the first color, and I would kind of work it in there a little bit. so that you don't see an abrupt transition, you see a gradual transition. And when I do this, I really have to stand back and look at it, but it helps it to recede in space. And then in the background, I would use a blue-gray, actually this. Red, yellow, and blue. I'm gonna use my cool red, alizarin. And that's kind of like just my floor color, you know, back there, which is handy. Let's try this. That's okay. See, it harmonizes with everything else because it's made from everything else. It might be darker than I want. I don't know yet. I'm trying not to fill this in like I'm painting the side of my house. Well, let's shape this. And then I want a soft edge. So I would mix this and this together. See if that works and put it right on there. There is a soft edge. And I would do the same thing over here. Soft edge, blue, back there, blue gray. And maybe a few little holes here and there, you know? So it's still pretty rough, but it gives you an idea. And then that middle gray color is what I see here with the jar. And then it gets lighter. I'm doing this so fast. I know I normally would not paint this fast. This is a little squatty jar. This is pretty light right here. It's a little bit redder. Picking up some red from somewhere, a kind of peachy color. Then I just look at the shapes that I see and put little marks. Doesn't have to look exactly like it. And then down here, there's that gray. Goes this way. This goes this way, and there's, thankfully, there's a little bit of that phthalo blue coming in a couple places. So let's see. Here's the green that I see in the bottom. This is lighter. A little bit lighter here. Nice dark mark right there. Mm-hmm. Okay, water line.
So Karen, are you gonna leave out the orange flower in the back?
No, I'm not gonna leave it out.
Okay.
But I don't have time to paint it.
Okay.
So I really only have time to paint a couple of flowers. So
well, sorry. Karen, what we could do is you could, if you work on it some more, you could send me the finished painting and I can send it out in the June 1st newsletter to let everybody sure. know how it ended up.
Sure, I definitely will finish it. So it's hard to get me to stop.
No, we're loving it. Are you kidding?
So I really want to put on some of the bling, you know? It's about, I would say, 3/4 done. That's it, I guess.
Thank you. And everybody look up Karen's website, KarenWernerArt.com, and you can see more of her incredible paintings, like the one in the way back of the doll and all the children's things and the bear and the cat and the hat. That is one of my all-time, my favorites of yours, Karen.
Thank you. That was fun to do.
She's got beautiful work, and we will definitely keep in touch with you and hopefully see you soon.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Bye, everybody. Thanks for coming.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.